still have.
You do. Right. Okay. Morning, everybody.
Morning.
It's good to be here with you. I was just trying to tuck this into a back pocket and I've discovered that this new pair of trousers, they've got buttons on the back pocket. That's what's a good idea. I'll tuck it in. Nor get the button on. Anyway, there we are. Yes, happy Christmas to you all. I trust you had a lovely day yesterday. I trust you had a lovely day today as well. And here to worship the Lord, which is a wonderful thing. That's what this season is all about, here to worship the Lord Jesus Christ who came into this world 2 millennia ago. It's marvellous. Things either last or they don't last, don't they? God's not a fan of empires, I've noticed as I've grown up. Any empire that comes up is usually built on blood, sweat and toil of others. And after a while, he finishes them off. Roman Empire's probably the longest lasting, I think. But his empire, his kingdom, it says in Isaiah 9, of his kingdom, of his government, and of peace, there shall be no end. No end whatsoever. Well, we'll wait for the lady. How are you? Yes, of his government and of peace, there will be no end. Last week I gave something of my testimony, age of 12, Christmas 1978. Lord Jesus Christ met me and saved me. I'm sure some of my friends at school after that thought that it might just be a phase or I might just give up if they threw enough of my stuff out of the window just before the teacher came into a class. I might just give up. But I didn't. And here I am, 55. Age of 50, not 55 years later, I was going to say, age of 55, all those years later, and still following the Lord's marvelous thing, it lasts, what Jesus Christ does lasts. Okay, so welcome to you all. Well, come on, I'll see you. That's it. Oh, and a dog. Excellent. Who can think of scripture to do with dogs? Not that dogs are outside, they're not there, it's no one but dogs. Statement of faith by the Syrophoenician one, wasn't it? Even the little dogs, the crumbs that fall from the master's table. But we don't have to be content with crumbs because we've been invited to the feast and we're here as invited guests of Jesus Christ to banquet and feast with him. Okay, now we have some notices, which come through from last week, which basically is, if you have a notice sheet, which I don't now have the glasses, so there's no prayer meeting this week, I think there's no prayer meeting? No, is there? I'm looking for a no or a yes.
No.
No? No, okay. No prayer meeting this week. Next Sunday, morning worship is led by some chap called Ray Bullock. I don't know whether I'll roll up to listen to that or not. But anyway, so that's that. I think that's it, really, sort of notices-wise. Obviously, we're coming into a new year, a new start. I hope, you know, this morning, and we can pray into that, can't we? We can pray into that. And so we look back at what God has done. We look forward to what God is going to do as well. And obviously, remember the list of various people for prayer. We're in need of prayer. They're on that list there. Obviously, do remember Eric at this time and Joyce, who lift them up to the Lord in your prayers. Let's just pray, shall we? And then we'll go to sing. Father in heaven, we want to thank you that we're able to be here this morning to rejoice in your presence. We thank you that we can rejoice in each other's company. We thank you that we're a family of people that you have that you've chosen. You've chosen. When we look at ourselves, sometimes we look at others and we say, yeah, I know why God chose that person. Sometimes when we look at ourselves, we're not so sure. And yet you did, out of your free grace, out of your great love. And when we consider the alternative, which is not being received, not being accepted in the beloved, is that rejection. We're glad that you accepted us, Jesus. We're glad that we received you. We're glad that that you gave us faith in our hearts to believe in you, to trust in you. And we thank you that at Christmas time we remember that you came into this world to make that possible, to bring about the fullness of your plan of salvation. We thank you that we read in your scripture that you came out with a sense of delight. I delight to do your will, O God. And we pray, Jesus, this morning that we would have delight in worshipping you. And God, too, if we can bring some delight to your heart as well, that would make it most worthwhile indeed. So bless us now as we worship you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Right, we are going to sing a couple of songs, Joy to the World to start with, and then Emmanuel, which is Manger, Hallowed Manger Ground. Okay, so please stand to sing or remain seated if you are not up to the stand.
Thank you.
Yes, indeed. Okay, I'm just going to take a reading now. I'm going to take a reading from God's Word, and then we're going to come to a young person. I don't know of any young people this morning, but it's lovely to see you. Well, plenty of people here younger than me, but young people, it's good to see. Right, okay, we're going to read from Luke chapter 2, actually, Luke chapter 2. We're going to read verses 67 to 79. Luke does like a lot. Now, Luke didn't write chapters. For some reason, we divided Luke up into long chapters, not two, rather one. The theory was that the horse bucked whenever they sort of, that'll be when we're looking at a chapter division. But there's Luke chapter 2, we'll start reading at verse 60. Is this right? Is this not right? What am I talking about? Excuse me. Luke chapter 1. Luke chapter 1, that makes more sense. Luke chapter 1, verse 67. Okay. This is Zacharias' prophecy. Zacharias was the father of John the Baptist. Okay. Luke chapter 1, verse 67. Now, his father Zacharias was filled with the Holy Spirit and prophesied, saying, Blessed is the Lord God of Israel, who has visited and redeemed his people, and has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets, who have been since the world began, that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to perform the mercy promised to our fathers, and to remember his holy covenant, the oath which he swore to our father Abraham, to grant us that we, being delivered from the hand of our enemies, might serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him, all the days of our life. And you, child, will be called the prophet of the highest, for you will go before the face of the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation to his people by the remission of their sins, through the tender mercy of our God, with which the day spring from on high has visited us. I love that phrase. The day spring from on high has visited us. Lovely. To give light to those who sit in darkness and the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. Amen. Now, we're not necessarily going to be, we will get to think about that passage at some point, but it might not be today, it might be next week. Right then. Okay. I trust the people got some presents. Yes, they've got presents. Yes, they have got presents. Did anyone get a present? No? Oh gosh. Well, there's going to be presents. Okay. Presents are good, aren't they? Presents are quite good. So, now, our young students, Rebecca Thomas, what did you get for Christmas? Anything exciting?
A boot bag.
A boot bag. Excellent. What sort of boots go in this bag? Football boots, excellent, very good indeed. Excellent. What brand is it?
Ipswich Town.
Ipswich Town. Okay. Can I suggest that maybe? No. That's very good indeed. I hope you play for them one day. It could be an improvement. Yeah, you could join up and show them how it's done. Sorry, anyway, I'm not sure. Good bag. Excellent. Good bag. Very, very handy. Okay, what did you get? You got a new watch. Excellent. Very nice. Oh, that looks like one of these highfalutin watches. Does it do anything?
Yeah,
it counts your steps, does it?
Yeah.
Excellent. Okay. How many have you done today so far?
1,000.
That's quite a lot. Is that quite a lot of steps? I don't have one. That's quite a lot of steps already on that. Excellent. Your mum didn't get me to work very hard this morning, is it? No? Oh, right. Okay. Excellent. Does it tell you other things as well?
Yeah.
It does.
The time of the day. How many steps I need
to get. Excellent. Very good. Do you know why I don't wear one of those? Because I don't want to know how lazy I am. No, I don't know. I certainly don't want one telling me what my blood pressure is at any given point. Certainly the hypochondriac. We know all that. Anybody else got anything of renown that they would like to share? At all? I got a big basket of something yesterday. And if I consume it all by next week, I won't have this racing steak figure. chocolate, quite a lot of chocolate. I don't even like stuff. So that will take me a little while to consume. Jeremy got on here the last time. I'm not Moby, actually. Moby. It's quite a thoughtful singer. So Jeremy got on here and has a Moby CD, which I'll be listening to in the car. CD's getting a bit old fashioned now. I should say something else. But I'd like something to hold on, do something with. But yes, indeed. So that's good. Nice to get things for Christmas, isn't it? Nice to be remembered. Nice to get a card. Nice to get a greeting. I was speaking to my mum yesterday, and she said to me, send off cards sometimes. She said, send off cards, you can't come back. She said, from year to year, sometimes you touch people, and they don't come, and then there's no... She says, why are they still alive or not sometimes? But it's a sad thing. But anyway, it's good to get things at Christmas. It's good to receive, and it's in... I don't know whether it's a bit of the old bar humbug coming out. No, I don't think so. But Christmas is like on steroids, isn't it? So pumped up and so hyped up. Go. And I just thought, do you know what? If I was the Pope of Christmas, in other words, what I said went, I would just say, well, do you know what? Just bang all the going out and the frenetic energy, and we're just going to have 2 days sitting quietly, doing nothing, just relaxing and just being calm, enjoying each other's company. Board games, so whatever, anything, just to cease with the frenetic energy. Because that's not what it's about, is it? It's not what it's about. It's about Jesus Christ. Now, we've got a little piece here that I didn't find, but was found by Ron and Julie. Ron and Julie are away from the family for a few days, which is good. And it's called A Bethlehemian Rhapsody. You may have heard of it, you may have seen it. And it has the music of the Bohemian Rhapsody, but it's done by the Muppets, as you know, the Muppets. And well, I watched it this morning with bated breath, I have to say, but with an open mind as well. And it's nice. It's nicely done. Has anybody seen it before? Is it all? Oh, you have. Excellent. Very good. Yeah, so we're going to watch that together now. Maybe I'll have to sit down and enjoy it as well.
I'm sorry.
Judith's got a poem that she's going to come and share with us. Now, is this, will this be an honour to use?
What colour is it on the tape?
What's that again?
There's a colour tape around the mic.
Red. Oh, is it? Oh, couldn't you use that one?
Yeah, I can use the hand one, yeah.
Okay. Songs of praise. We realise there's only songs we only sing at Christmas time, but it's on our heart the year round that you ever came into this world. But we thank you that you came out of great love for us in Jesus Christ. Thank you for that. Thank you for love that in your heart was love. For God so loved the world. You did not want the world to be condemned, but that we might live through your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you that if we know him this morning, we have life dwelling within us. We have life eternal dwelling in us. We thank you that we are no longer in darkness, but we are in light. The light of the world dwells within us. And we thank you, Jesus, that when we come to look at your word, we can look at it not with darkened minds, but with illuminated minds. When we think about the things of yourself, we don't think about them in a fleshly way, a diminished way, but in a way that has been liberated. Our minds have been set free. Have the mind of Christ, the scripture says. And so we thank you that when we come to scripture, we can enjoy it. And if we don't quite understand it, we thank you that we have you, the helper, Holy Spirit, to illuminate us. We thank you for many resources we can look at as well to understand your word, to derive the greatest benefit from it. So we ask Jesus this morning, as we look at your word, you will bless us and feed us and nourish us, Lord, we pray. We thank you for the joy of being here. Blessing of being here. We thank you for the health of being able to be here. We remember those who can't be here through one form of unwellness or another. We want to lift them up to you, Lord. We lift them up to you and ask for your touch upon their lives, for healing, for well-being. Lord God, for strength and well-being and peace for those who have the care and the concern and the worry and all that goes along with seeing loved ones unwell, Lord. We thank you that you're a high priest who knows, who sympathizes, who empathizes. We thank you that you come alongside us. We pray, Jesus, that you draw alongside to all those in need from our midst this morning. Remember again Eric, Lord, and Joyce, lift them up to you. Remember Barbara, Lord, and remember Anna, lift them up to you, Lord. Others who are known to us, Lord Jesus Christ, are in need of your touch and your strength, your blessing, your help, your comforts, your consolation. Please, Jesus, would you come and minister this morning by your Spirit and bring peace and help, Lord, as only you can. We thank you, Jesus, that in our extremities often you find your opportunity. Where, Lord God, our resources and our knowing just what to do for another person sometimes just runs out. Yet we thank you that you never run out of your ability to help people, to bring solace. We thank you for that. We thank you that there is never not a balm in Gilead with you. We thank you that there is always a healing balm. And we pray that you would apply it to hearts and minds and lives that are in need of that this day, we pray. Thank you, Jesus, that you came because you care, that you love us. Thank you that you just come to save us from our sins, but we read that in your body as well, you carried our sicknesses, our infirmities, all the ways us down as people as well. So we thank you that we can bring these things to you and leave them with you, and know that we can find help and strength and blessing in time of need. And so we do that, Jesus. We do it for people who find it are unable to do it for themselves this day. We pray, Jesus, that you'd answer prayer. We thank you that we read how instantaneously you did things in Scripture. And we pray, Jesus, that you would do that even as we pray together this morning. We thank you too, Jesus, that we join a worldwide company of your people who rejoice in this time of year. We thank you, God, that there are those who you've brought out of the darkest of religions, or you've brought out of no religion, you've brought out of traditions, Lord. We thank you that you're saving people out of all kinds of things. We thank you that even this year, in a materialistic year, you will save people out of materialism and set them free in yourself, Lord. We thank you that you're a God who sets people free. We thank you that the gospel, as Paul said, you know, he was chained, but the gospel was not chained. We thank you that your word, your gospel, is beamed into countries, it's broadcast into countries, it goes by the internet into countries, all of the time, every hour of the day. We bless you for that. We thank you for your servants who serve you, talents in other nations, Lord. In nations of great difficulty, nations where there's great opposition, Lord. We think of brothers and sisters who are imprisoned this day, Lord. Brothers and sisters who are isolated. We think of very young brothers and sisters of ours who are very young in years and young in faith, Jesus. And we thank you that they have a joy about them, Lord. We pray that you would bless them in their faith, Lord, and nurture them. And we thank you, God, that you're bringing out a great family of people to yourself out of all the families of the earth. A great common language that we will sing one day out of all the languages of the earth and all the dialects of the earth. We thank you that you're bringing a great variety of people, poor, rich, well-educated, ill-educated, Lord, people who are, you know, fighting fit, people with disabilities. We thank you that in heaven all will be well. We thank you that it is a story of redemption, it is a story of final redemption, it is a story of making people whole, and it is a story of final wholeness as well. It is a story of what we see in part now, but a story of what we will see in full then. And we bless you for that. Lord, we pray, Jesus, that would give us an excuse to veil ourselves from your glory now, that you would continue to reveal yourself to us and help us to reveal ourselves to you as well. Please, we pray that we might enjoy you and to bask in your presence, Lord. As chief end of man, to glorify God and to enjoy the breath. Help us to glorify you and to enjoy you. Bless us now as we look into your word. For your name's sake we pray. Amen. Amen. Right, yes, we're going to consider some thoughts around the Christmas story, you'll be pleased to hear. from God's word. We had that reading from Zacharias. I was thinking of speaking on Zacharias this morning, and I might get to that stage, or I might not. It might come next week. That'll be next week, judging by the clock. So so we will start off where we're going to start off, and we'll get to where we get, and we'll do the rest from next week. But if you would like, as an exercise, to read from Luke chapter 1, verses 5 to 25, between now and next week, that would be good. Luke 1, 5 to 25. Now, if you're in a life group, which incidentally won't begin again until the fifth of January. We are looking at John's Gospel, and we've not got a booklet, we're just, more extempore than that. But what we're thinking about is what is in people. There's this verse that fascinates me, actually. At the end of John chapter 2, and it says, John says about Jesus didn't need anybody to tell him what was in any person, for he himself, Jesus himself, knew what was in every person. I find that fascinating. Which exactly explains why he goes up to people and he cuts across anything they say and just presents it with you. Now, we have chapters, obviously, but when John was writing it, he didn't have end of chapter 2, beginning of chapter 3. So we have that sort of little psychological break. So if you tip X out of chapter 3, which all right, the world won't cave, the skies won't cave in if you do tip X out of the number. But it goes straight into, there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, and this man came to Jesus by night. And he said, and then Jesus said to him, you find out what was in Nicodemus. John does that. He talks a lot about what was in people, and that's what we're doing. That is our thing of thinking what was in people. And if you read those verses, Luke 1, 5 to 25, just think about what is going on there in Zacharias, okay? And we'll come to the reason for that in a little while. Right, okay. I've been listening to a book on Audible, which, I even volunteer sometimes for cleaning jobs that I don't particularly want to do, because I think, oh, that'll give me a chance to listen to my book. Because I know I'll be on my own, and I can put it in the pocket and walk around, and there's this chattering voice in my pocket, or I stick it up somewhere, find the optimum acoustic environment, and they do vary quite a lot, to get it. Now I've been listening to Dare to Call Him Father, Bilkishek. If you've never read it, it's from a few years ago now, but do read it. Or get it on Audible and listen to it. If you've been a bit delayed giving somebody a Christmas present, then Audible is very good. And it's fantastic. I'm listening to the story a second time. That lady, she came, she was a Muslim, Pakistan, high up, government, husband, been a government official, and she said she would read the Quran out of a sense of duty, really. But had no thoughts about Christianity at all. That was anathema. She had Christian sermons, and every now and then she would hear about a Christian sermon that a Christian had been killed. An honour killing. They'd become an apostate, left the faith, and therefore, it doesn't have to follow through that depends how you read the Quran. So some people take it into their hands, just member of the family to kill somebody who converts to Christianity out of Islam. Anyway, this lady, Bilkish, she's a very intelligent lady. You can tell. It's an extraordinary book. I think, sure, there's a particular anointing on that book. If you have Audible, the only time you shouldn't listen to it is when it's driving. If you're given to shedding a few tears whilst you're listening to the emotion of the story, driving is not a great thing to be doing when that occurs. But it's an amazing story. She had a dream. She said, I hadn't dreamed for years, years and years, dreamt about nothing. And not just in that term, but probably sort of metaphorically in her life as well, she hadn't dreamt about anything for years. And she had a dream that Jesus visited her, and he came to stay for 2 days, and they had meals together. And then the scene transferred to John the Baptist standing on a mountain. That's how her journey of faith came. Astonishing story, absolutely astonishing story. And the Lord uses dreams and visions in the Muslim world quite a lot to bring people to himself. Okay, and I was thinking about what to speak on this time, and I was thinking about Zacharias and the events around his life. And then I thought about the wider events around God sending his son into this world. Now, if you read the Gospel of John, he doesn't give an account of the birth. If you read the Gospel of Mark, he's straight into it. This is the Gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. He doesn't do it, and then straight to John the Baptist. He doesn't do the birth of Jesus Christ. Matthew and Luke are the two Gospels that really go into quite some detail about the incarnation, the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ. So if I said to you, you can put your hand up or call out a number if you like, how many out of the ordinary occurrences, i.e. sort of God-generated happenings, you might even call them supernatural, occurred, that's recorded in Matthew and Luke surrounding the birth of Jesus Christ? They can include all sorts of things that we would definitely say are out of the ordinary. How many do you think there might be? I've never counted them before, and I was quite surprised. And I was reading, and I missed a couple. I counted 15 out of the way occurrences. And then those are fairly extraordinary as well, maybe it's 17 occurrences. I did get to 12 to start with. I think that counts as twice. So that came up to 13. And then I reread it, and I thought, I missed those two. And I went up to 15. And then I thought about 17. So that includes, I'm going to run through what they are, okay? And you can agree or disagree. Those of them, I think you can pretty much say that they're all extraordinary occurrences. These things haven't happened for hundreds of years. Hadn't happened for hundreds hundreds of years. It gives a thing there, 400 years, we say 400 years of science. It's been longer than that. I started reading Isaiah this week, and I haven't read Isaiah for at least a couple of years now. And I read the first two chapters, and I thought, that's remarkable. But Isaiah opens, actually, which also got me thinking. It opens as two chapters opening. This is what it says. This also got me thinking. It's very interesting turns of phrase that the Lord inspires his servants to use. It starts off by saying, the vision of Isaiah, the son of Amos, which he saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem in the days of the following kings. And then it goes into chapter 1, and what chapter that is. Then chapter 2 starts, the word that Isaiah, the son of Amos, saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem. The word that he saw. I thought, that's an interesting turn of phrase. I might give that some thought. Sometimes the word that he saw. And for that, that's an extraordinary way. And probably it delved into the Hebrew at the top, helped to expand it out, but I don't have time to do that. But here, extraordinary things. So I've got, this is not in chronological order. In Matthew 1, we've obviously got Joseph. He's thinking about what to do with Mary because she's pregnant. And he's not too sure what to do. As he's thinking about these things, an angel of the Lord comes to him in a dream and says, take her to your wife. Matthew chapter 2, verse 2, we have the wise men. They say they see the star in the east, and then they head west. Marvelous. They didn't follow the star all the way. It disappeared. They saw it and said, this is it. Over west, there's a king born. Marvelous. You know, it's an act of illumination of faith, they believed. They saw the star again, Matthew 2 and 9, after they come out of the very grim experience of being in Herod's palace, and says they, the star that they had seen in the east, they saw again. And they followed it, which is an extraordinary thing in itself. So there's three of them. Then they're warned in a dream not to return to see Herod, but to go over another way. Then, chapter 2, verse 13, Joseph is warned in a dream to flee. Matthew 2, 19, he's told to return. Matthew chapter 2, verse 22, he's told in a dream again to turn aside and live somewhere else, and he selects a sort of out of the way place of Nazareth. So that's all those extraordinary occurrences there. Those things don't happen every day, and this is what God was doing. And Joseph is an incredibly obedient person. You know, he was aroused out of sleep, and he went and did. You know, he got up. He's an ideal employee. He just gets up and gets on with it. So whether he's a sense of duty, but he feels this compulsion to do what he's been told to do. He doesn't loiter or hang around, and that's what God likes, isn't it? You know, it's hearts that actually take action when he speaks to them. Then you come into Luke, and you have here in Luke chapter 1, you have the angel Gabriel appearing to Zacharias, and we're going to think about that next week. And yes, indeed. And he gives Zacharias a message. Then Luke 26 to 38, which is a song. Where are we here? Yes, then we have the song of Mary. There's another extraordinary thing, actually. When Mary goes to visit Elizabeth, and then Elizabeth is, I think she's 6 months pregnant at this time, and Mary is just newly expecting. See, John the Baptist, when he hears the sound of Mary's voice, he leaps in the womb of Elizabeth. And she said, leapt in the womb at the voice of my Lord. And and it says that John the Baptist was filled with the Holy Spirit from the womb. So the fetal John leapt for joy in recognition at the Lord Jesus Christ, who was an embryo, probably an embryonic stage, in Mary. That's an extraordinary event, isn't it? That doesn't happen every day in a hospital, does it? So absolutely a phenomenal thing. So that occurred as well. And then there's the song that Mary sings, and there's the song that Zacharias sings. Then you come into Luke chapter 2, and you have Ananias, and there was Simeon coming into the temple by being moved by the Holy Spirit. He sees this baby, and he takes this baby in his arms, and he says, "This one, this is the one. Now you are letting your servant depart in peace, for mine eyes have seen your salvation." Okay, absolutely phenomenal. He did this by the Holy Spirit. Then Anna comes in at that time, and she sees this occurrence. And then she speaks of him to all those, the other unusual occurrence, who are looking for the redemption of Jerusalem. That's Mark's, isn't it? People looking for the redemption of Jerusalem. People are actually that God is working by, it's called prevenient grace. He's always really working in their heart in a way, preparing them for what comes next. The other amazing occurrences in Zacharias is that it says there was a multitude of people praying. That's good, isn't it? You don't get that often. A multitude of people praying outside at the hour of incense. So that was what was occurring around the birth of Jesus Christ. An extraordinary event. If anybody says to you, what's special about the birth of Jesus Christ? You can just open this up and look at all these extraordinary events and say, is there any other human being that you know that all these events surrounded them? And they brought a lot of it is. There's fear, isn't there? It generates a certain amount of fear in people's hearts, and that's fair enough. There's an angel involved. The angel always says, do not be afraid. But then there's always this sense of rejoicing in people. People go in search. They go looking for what the angel says. Go down to Bethlehem and search. And the shepherds go and search. The wise men go and search. There's this finding. There's this faith. There is finding. There is a telling of what they see. There's a glorifying. There's a worshipping. All these things occur out of what God is doing, what he communicates to human beings, and then their response. So they respond to what God is doing in this very overflowing way. So there's obedience, there's faith, there's searching, there's glorifying, there's praising, there's worshipping, there's giving of gifts, and there's going out and telling others as well. So it's an extraordinary time, absolutely extraordinary time. Principal shepherds, I'm just a poor boy, nobody loves me. Go out and tell other people what Jesus Christ has done. I said, well, these shepherds are on something tonight. It's incredible. I've never seen them so enthusiastic or enthralled. That's what they were. They were enthralled by what God was doing at that time. And as I was thinking about this, my mind sort of moved kind of laterally along. And I thought to myself, I wonder what it's like for the angels to be involved in this. What was it like for angels to be doing this work? I love Luke chapter 1, verse 28. It says, and having come in, I don't know how that was, but the angel came in through the door just to where Mary was and so on. It's something for the imagination, isn't it? And having come in, the angel said to her, rejoice, highly favored one, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women. You know, I just think of that angel. I think he's up in heaven. And God says, now, go now. And he goes, whoosh, goes. And he's there in an instant. He gives this message. How do you think he gave that message? What do you think his demeanor was like? You know, from what I'm conveying to you now, you can only tell what it means to me. 7% of what I am conveying to you now comes through my words, the words that I use. About mid 30% is my intonation. Do I sound enthusiastic about if I was standing here? And the angel came in and he was very excited about you saying, I did nothing much to grip that man. So the words and the intonation, and then the rest of it is body language. That's the majority of over half of what we convey is our body language, which makes Zoom is marvellous, but it makes it a bit limiting for conveying the message, you know? Sort of preaching truth through personality and so on. If you can just see a little head bobbing around and so on, you've got to rely. And if you're having counselling sessions through Zoom as well, it's better than nothing at all, but the counsellor can't see if you're sort of flushing here or something's affecting your skin, how it's colouring up, or whether your foot's tapping, your knee's going, your head's going, can't tell any of those little tells about people, about what they're thinking and feeling, how they are in the moment, can't see any of that. So the complete thing is important. So how do you think the angel was? I think his presence was full on, you know, really sort of rejoice. And he has this great joy about what he's, the task that he's been given. So my mind did a little bit of imagining as well, you know. God had this array of angels, and he said, hands up, who wants to go and tell Mary? How many hands do you think went up? This is, obviously, this is just thinking. But what I'm trying to convey here is, you know, God selected an angel. But I imagine that every angel there was wanted to be the one to share that message. That's what I think. Everyone else wanted to. Because you know how I know that? Because if you turn over to Hebrews 1:14, the writer there says angels. Are they not ministering spirits sent forth to minister, to serve to those who will inherit salvation? That's what their job is. That is part of their job. So if they're saying, well, bit indifferent about drag tell me. They rolled up his job. It went to one in particular to go. And he comes in with this, thrilled by this message. And the response of, but when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, considered what manner of greeting this was. Amazing. But I think the angel was conveying, and when the angels came and sang, glory to God in the highest, glory of God shone around, they were just conveying their own joy at being involved in the outworking of the salvation purposes of God. But they were conveying what God was feeling as well. His joy at the start of it. His joy about sending his son into this world. His joy about what he was accomplishing. That in the fullness of time, God sent forth his son. That's what it says in Galatians. And this was the fullness of time. And he was enacting that, should we say, the final stage of salvation. Marvellous. I think it's quite a big thing to think about. I think it's worth thinking about that God is cooperating with man. Man becomes excited about it. Women become excited about it. Clever people become excited about it. Poor people become excited about it. About what God is doing, because God is thrilled to be doing what he is doing. And the angels are thrilled to be as well. So this is great joy going on. I had never thought about that cooperation until this evening. I've never thought about it until then. So I'm presenting to you something that is quite fresh to me. And I hope I'm presenting it in a way that comes across as I found quite exciting to think about as well. So then my mind went on a little bit as well to, what it's like for God. You know, we're a blend, aren't we, human beings? We can have joy, we can have sadness, we can weep, laugh, and so on. And I wonder what it was like for God. You know, you were there, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, from eternity. I am who I am. If I was in need, I would not tell you. God is never in need. He is self-sufficient one, self-sufficient in every way. So he does not need us, he doesn't need anything. He is complete in himself, the Godhead complete in themselves. And the Son with him from eternity in glory. And the time approaches, fullness of time approaches, and at a given moment, the fullness of time, the Son disappears. Gone. Not there anymore. Gone. Person next to you. Gone. Gone to be in the womb of Mary. Do you know how many cells make up an embryo? I always say this, you know, if you're medically inclined, you will know this, but I didn't. How many cells make up an embryo on day two of a pregnancy? How many cells? That is four cells. On day three, it's 6 to 8 cells. Do you know how many cells in a grown person? 37.2 trillion. That's what they've worked it out at. Absolutely amazing. Inside just about every cell, there's also DNA. There's DNA. If you unfold that DNA, it'll come to a thin, thin strand, 2 meters long. If you stretched us out, from one to the other, we can go from one side of the solar system back to the other side. Okay? Okay. I've shared it before when I was doing a children's talk. So if any of you say I'm feeling a bit stretched, there's a lot of you to be stretched. Okay. So that's what it is. So this is how our mind was working. Okay. This is, we talk about the condescension of God. God contracted to a span, incomprehensibly made man. So there he was, Jesus. You know, we sing, don't we, at Christmas, our God, heaven cannot hold him, nor the earth contain. Heaven and earth will flee away when he comes away. We recognize that immense, beyond everything. You know, God is outside of the universe. He's not in the universe. He's not bound by the universe. He's outside. It can expand for as much as it likes. It will never contain God. God is outside of it. Okay. He is in the womb of a woman, 32, 7.2 trillion cells, and she can be stretched from one side of the solar system to the other, and he becomes four cells, can stretch from one side of the womb to the other. Now that's condescension, isn't it? That God becomes man in that way. Sacrifice. We ever wonder what it's got? We look at Calvary and say, God sacrifices, don't we? And sometimes we think that's a massive sacrifice. And we look at our own lives and we sort of have to make sacrifices at times and how it goes along. And we think about the life of Jesus Christ, you know, sacrifices that the Godhead made. You know. When he made human beings, Adam, the woman, called Eve, he made them fully grown, 37.2 trillion cells. That's how he made them, with all those inside them. And then, phenomenal, absolutely phenomenal. But he chooses, he says, I am prepared to become four cells. I'm prepared to become four cells in order to accomplish your will, Father. I delight to do your will. It is written in the law, your law is in my heart. I delight to do your will, O God. That's what it says. And that's what he does. And that's I've never thought about that before until this year. It's quite an awakening, isn't it? All those years as a Christian, I've never really considered those things before. But that is what Jesus Christ did for us. He came down. And then I thought of the practical outworking of it as well. You know, God delighted to send his son, for God so loved the world. The son was happy to come. I delight to do your will, O God. Psalm 40. The Holy Spirit is engaged. He makes it possible. The power of the Most High will overshadow you. And, it says in Luke, doesn't it? Let me read the verses. Anyway, when it's the operation of the Holy Spirit upon Mary, that Jesus comes into to Mary. So the triune God involved in it. But I thought to myself, we make our sacrifices and we say, yes, that's good, that gives me joy in doing that. And there are times as well there is sadness involved as well, isn't there? There can be sadness and surrender. And I thought to myself, I wonder if God ever looked to his side and thought, down there. Cells forming down there. And that just made me think of empty seats at Christmas, you know. Empty seats at Christmas. So God knows what it's like to have an empty seat at Christmas. And whilst he did it out of love, I don't think that our hearts quite mirror God's heart if we didn't recognize that in his heart there must be some sadness as well. Possibility of sadness, his son not being there, an empty chair at Christmas. So he knows what it's like, knows what it feels like, knows that as well, the deep was done, it was unchangeable. It would change in the future. People who have lost loved ones this year, we know that will change in the future, we'll see them again. But for the time being, it's an empty space. And sometimes we do wonder, but does God really know what this is like? I do. Yeah. I've been theologically trained. But he does. It does, because I thought to myself, yeah, first Christmas Day, we'll call it the first Christmas Day, God had an empty seat next to him. Which is, I think, is an amazing thought, hopefully a comforting thought, that God knows what it is like. As I was thinking about that this morning, I had tears in my eyes. I thought about the Spurs, those who find themselves in a place like God found himself in an empty seat next to him. And it was he who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I never really know what the secret place was. I still don't claim that I know what it fully is. But I think there are those places that God has entered into. He's working with human beings. And what he experiences through working with us, and what he plans, and what he sacrificed, that is like a secret place that only he knows the full depth of. And he says, you know, if you want some comfort, I've been there. Come into that secret place with me and find my shadow. And I will be almighty for you in your time of need. I will be all that you need and more in your time of need. That's what I think as well. I think that's part of the Christmas message as well. Whilst it's rejoicing, there's also that element as well. Now, there's one exception to the rule of the happiness and the joy that was brought to people at this first Christmas, and that was Zacharias. I've run out of time, so if you want to know about that, you'll have to come back next week. Or if you've been unstimulated, you know, next week. But some trust that you have. So have a read of that, and just prepare your minds for that. Okay. So Christmas is a joy, isn't it? Because God enters in to a human experience, to a lived human being. Multitude of ways, but primarily our sin and death and the regions of darkness. Amen. We are going to sing. We're going to sing a lovely carol, Hark the Herald Angels Sing, Glory to the Newborn King. Christ the Christ, Heaven Adored, Christ the Everlasting.
Oh,
have so much to rejoice in. Thank you for your goodness towards us. Thank you for your love. Thank you for the change that you've brought into our hearts. Help us to continue to be transformed by that work of your Spirit in our lives, that we might be more like Jesus. Help us to be the incarnation of Jesus, we pray, in this poor old world we live in today. For your name's sake. Amen. Thank you.